How many errors can you see in this figure? Freeze the video and write down as many errors as you can find. The answer will be revealed later in this video. Stay tuned. Hello aviators, how are you today? My name is Magna Nordahl. I'm an airline captain and instructor. Earlier in this channel, I have made some videos about how a wing produces lift. The latest video is called How Can Airplanes Fly Upside Down? You will find a link in the description below and up here. The videos have resulted in many comments and discussions, which is great. But they also reveal there are some misconceptions literally floating around. And this is what I will discuss in this video. So fasten your seatbelt. Here are the top 7 ideas about wing lift that do not work. And I promise you, the last one will blow your mind. Stay tuned. The equal transit time hypothesis has been taught to pilots and kids in science classes all over the world. The idea is that air going above the wing has a longer path to travel due to the curved shape. So the air parcels going over the top must travel faster in order to meet the air parcels that went underneath the wing at the same time. And in accordance with Bernoulli's equation, a higher velocity over the wing results in a reduction of the static air pressure, which is lift. Very often is the explanation illustrated like this. But air doesn't behave like that. How many errors do you see? I will give you the answer at the end of the video. It is correct that the static pressure in an airstream is reduced when the velocity increases. This happens because of conservation of energy. But the air parcels are not married, they are divorced by the wing. And since we are not dealing with quantum physics, they cannot know where the other is. Wind tunnel demonstrations show that the air flowing over the wing moves much faster than the air flowing under the wing. Busted. Bernoulli's equation or Newton's third law of motion? You do not have to choose one of them. They complement each other. Bernoulli's equation is about flow speed, surface pressure, and conservation of energy. Newton is about force, flow direction, and conservation of momentum. We are looking at the same thing, lift, but from a different point of view. Likewise, it is wrong to say Bernoulli's equation is only responsible for some of the total lift. The atmospheric pressure is 10 metric tons per square meter, and when the air is in motion, you get some hefty forces. Just look at a hurricane or a tornado. And please do not use the term Bernoulli lift or Newton lift. It is like calling an apple a motorbike. Busted. This idea originates from the Venturi tube. According to Bernoulli's equation, the total pressure in a tube with a flowing fluid is constant. When the tube is narrowed, the air is forced to flow at a higher velocity. This means the dynamic pressure is increased and the static pressure is reduced. The idea is that if you replace the upper half of the Venturi with a flat plate, you have a wing profile. This is called stream tube pinching, but the atmosphere is not a solid wall. You might see a pinching effect in a small wind tunnel where the ceiling and the floor will restrict the vertical movement of the airflow. But in the free atmosphere, the wing will affect a large volume of air. Just look at the exhaust stains on this Hawker Hurricane. The stains do not follow a straight line behind the exhaust stacks, but follows the airflow over the curved upper surface of the wing. Busted. A common claim is that the lift is created by the underside of the wing. The overside is just polished to reduce drag. Some people are comparing it with skipping a flat stone on the water or with water skiing. While water and air are fluids, there are some significant differences between them. Water is 800 times denser than air at sea level. Air is compressible, water is not. That's a huge difference. You can put a foil into the water and it will lift a heavy vessel out of the water. But skipping the water surface is not lift as experienced by hydrofoils in the water or wings in the air. Other argument is that you can hold a flat plate or your hand out a car window and feel a lifting force, Yes, but there is also a lot of drag involved. If the lift is created by the underside of the wing, then why does an aircraft lose lift and stall when the angle of attack exceeds the critical value? This illustration is from Aerodynamics by L.J. Clancy. It shows the pressure distribution over and under the wing at various angles of attack. Above the wing, the pressure is less than atmospheric pressure. Below the wing, the pressure is higher. And the difference is lift. When the angle of attack increases, the low pressure area over the wing increases and moving forward, increasing the lift coefficient. Notice that the high pressure area under the wing remains near constant. When exceeding the critical angle of attack, the airflow over the wing separates, causing loss of lift, and that is stall. Conclusion: you cannot explain lift by looking at only one side of the wing. Busted. Some people argue that paper planes and model aircraft can fly with flat wings. Yes, but this only works when you have a very low wing loading. This paper airplane has a wing loading of 0.26 kilos per square meter. A fully loaded Cessna 172S has a wing loading of 71 kilos per square meter. That is 273 times more than the paper airplane. If you put a flat wing on a Cessna 172, I guarantee it will not fly. The reason is that a flat wing will stall at a very low angle of attack. Supersonic fighter jets have flat wings. They also have flaps that increases the curvature of the wing. This allows them to fly with a lower speed for takeoff and landing. Here is a video showing a giant paper plane made of foam. It did fly, but the lift-to-drag ratio is not good. You can compare it with the first generation of hang gliders. I have flown those. They had a lift-to-drag ratio of 4 to 1. Flat wings are terrible performers. Busted. Some people argue that lift is created by the Kanda effect. If that is correct, then the aircraft does not need forward speed to stay airborne. Just blow air over the wing and it will fly, right? But there is no aircraft in existence that can do that. Why? Because this is not how lift is created. The Kanda effect is associated with a jet of a fluid blasting into stationary fluid. In this case, a jet of air flowing into air. The jet causes the pressure in the surrounding air to drop. A jet pump works in that way. ATR aircraft has many jet pumps in the fuel system. If you place a solid surface close to the jet, the air pressure between the surface and the jet is reduced further, and the jet will stick to the surface. This effect is even stronger over a curved surface. The Kanda effect can be used to enhance lift, for example by using bleed air from the engine to blow over the flaps. This is used in the MiG-21 and Lockheed F-104 Starfighter and some other aircraft. This requires the engine to run at high power during approach. But the Kanda effect is not the cause of wing lift. Busted. The zone theory of lift is based on the idea that lift is the result of a suction force, F aero, which acts perpendicular to the upper surface of the airfoil, called the inductor. The area over the inductor is called the induction zone. The vertical vector of F aero is lift, and the horizontal vector is expansion force, Fexp. This expansion force is countered by thrust from the engines and causes expansion of the air in the induction zone. Consequently, the higher the thrust, the lower the air pressure in the induction zone and the higher the lift. Theoretically, the pressure can be as low as zero or complete vacuum. The forward part of the wing is called the deflector. Ahead of the deflector is the subduction zone, where the air pressure is higher than atmospheric pressure. It acts as a deflector, preventing the oncoming air mass from colliding with the wing. And here comes the strangest part of the theory. During flight, there is no flow of air over and under the airfoil. In other words, the air mass surrounding the wing is stationary. Behind the wing is the rear wake, an empty space which is filled by the surrounding air from all directions. If you want to study this theory further, you can check out the website takeoffone.com. you find a link below. My conclusion? This theory is completely disregarding known physics, so it's very easy to debunk. Okay, busted. How many errors did you find in this drawing? I will compare it with a better drawing showing how the streamlines really behave. First of all, the blue and red dots indicate the equal transit time idea, which is debunked. Number two, there is no downwash. Number three, the streamlines ahead and behind the airfoil are stepped. This is impossible in a gas. And four, there is no updraft ahead of the airfoil. If you want to learn more about lift, check out this video. And now I want to challenge you. What shall the next video be about? Let me know your ideas below in the comment section below. I promise to consider them very thoroughly. Thank you for watching. Have a wonderful day and happy landing.
200. 100. 50. 40. 30. 20.